Hello, my name's Sally Sudworth and I'm a chartered engineer and chartered environmentalist. I work at the Environment Agency. I'm the Net Zero Carbon Programme Manager and I also lead on sustainability for the flood and coast part of the business. I'm really pleased to be here today. I hope you enjoyed the short video that we just played, which is aimed at the asset management community in the Environment Agency, so in terms of managing sustainability and net zero carbon. So I have a few slides to share with you about the climate emergency, just to set the context of the scale of the challenge, of which I'm sure you're all aware, and also a few slides to share with you some ideas on what we can do as engineers to really make a difference through our decision making, and then some ideas on how you might like to get involved with some industry fora that have been set up to help like-minded engineers to tap into that coalition of the willing, as it were. So this quote, "Our thinking needs to change quicker than the climate," that was made by our chief exec, Sir James Bevan, who leads the Environment Agency. And this was in response to the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change report that was published back in October 2018, actually. And he said, "It's not as bad as you think, it's worse than that." Oh my goodness. So yes, there really is this sense of urgency now. That was in 2018. We were busy planning in 2019, and now we're in 2020, and it's certainly time to start taking action. So this slide shows we have business as usual, that trajectory. If we carry on, we're really not going to make that difference. And there are some things that are taking place in industry, in a number of sectors, but really that's not really going to get us where we need to be. What we need to bring about as a community is this transformational change to get to net zero carbon. That is the aspiration, and we can do it. I do believe we can do it as engineers, as society, if we do make that effort and raising awareness, I think, so people understand what it is they can do on both a personal level and as professionals, I think is key to that. So this slide looks at, we can see Climate Change Act there back in 2008, and then we had the Paris Agreement. We had 197 countries or thereabouts sign up to that. We had the demonstrations that took place last year, and there was the government response, or Parliament declared state of emergency, and some parts of government made that commitment to net zero carbon, and we certainly have at the Environment Agency. And just a nod to the standard there, 2080, which looks at carbon in infrastructure. So we have got some guidance that's out there. I'm sure you've all seen this graph of the extraordinary increase in global temperatures, and have heard of the frustration from Greta Thunberg et al., of course, who said that no one seems to be acting as though there's a real crisis. Come on, we need to get with it. And there is a feeling that with COVID-19, we did act as a society to limit the impact on the National Health Service. And that we could take the same approach if we act now and in a partnership way, and we cooperate across society, we can bring the impact of climate change back down to reasonable levels so that we can cope with the effects, just as the National Health Service were able to cope with that first wave of COVID. So yes, I'm sure you're familiar with this graph. So where are we now? So it's 5 years since we had that Paris Agreement, and that's where we were aiming for a global rise and increase in temperature of 2 degrees C, hoping for 2 degrees, aiming for 1.5. The current trend is towards 3.5 degrees C. If all the countries deliver on the agreements that have been put in place, we can only reduce it to 3.2, keep it within 3.2 degrees C. And how likely is that for all the countries to actually deliver on those agreements? Not sure. And we're already above 1°C warmer, and you'll have seen various reports and documentaries about the impact of that. One of the latest reports from the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change did say that we're unlikely to reach the 80% target, let alone the net zero. That's why it's really important that we as engineers make a difference where we can. So, yeah, some amazing photographs here. You can just see the scale of the challenge. And these photographs have been taken in recent years with regards to communities, both impacts from rivers and on the coast. So it's extraordinary. And I don't know whether you've seen this model that originated with the Institute of Asset Management, and that's recognising that it's not just the technical side of what it is that we need to do, but there are these various other aspects that help us operate as asset management organisations to be able to manage the infrastructure that we put in place in the UK or elsewhere, recognising that we have to have good data, that we have to manage risks, that we have to have the right people in place with the right skills, we need to plan well, and that decision making that has to be really good based on good quality data. But what I want to take you through to now is this asset management life cycle. Look at the different stages of that asset life cycle, and then we can start to think about the impact that we can make ourselves as engineers. So moving around the circle through design, construction, operation, maintenance, refurbishment, and then decommissioning, I've put some ideas here of the things that we can consider, take into account, just to whet your appetite. These aren't by no means the only things that we can do, but just some headlines to get you thinking. So there's a growing set of evidence that shows that if you take a whole life approach, low carbon solutions cost less. So there's a really good driver there in terms of wanting to deliver efficient assets in terms of infrastructure. And there's tangible evidence now to prove that. But that's when you take a whole life approach. So not just thinking about construction, but thinking about how that asset's going to be operated and maintained, etc., through its life cycle. We can use carbon planning tools and carbon calculators. We can make choices as engineers. We can consider environmental net gain, which is now part of hoping to become legislation, and we can consider working with nature rather than against it. Then in construction, there are some really exciting and interesting new techniques that are coming about with this 3D concrete printing. It has been trialled, so that will be a thing of the near future. Precast work, off-site construction, that's not a new idea. But I was fascinated to go along to see Boaty McBoatface, you know, the research vessel that has gone to the Antarctic, that was constructed in slices, in segments from around various parts of the country, and then were all brought, shipped together, and then welded together. So the ship was constructed in a series of slices, as opposed to constructing the vessel and then building the compartments inside. So that was a completely different way of manufacturing and putting together. So there's things like that that we can learn. Certainly in terms of the car industry, modular design now is becoming a real thing, where it's going to be easy to just take out a part of a car and replace it with another. And this won't be just parts of the engine, but the whole sort of any element of the car. So what is it that we can take from that and learn from that as civil engineers? there are choices to be made around the type of plant that we use. We can optimize resources during operation. There are self-healing assets now. There are whole systems in place that do self-diagnostics and then are able to issue reports on what needs to be done at what time. So we can have that timely intervention and really optimize the work that's done for a particular asset at any one time. And then we can use that asset health information to carry out a refurbishment or a replacement at the best time. And when we're talking 25, 50, 100 years in the future, the decisions that we're making now are going to really impact on those assets that are going to be in place by the end of the century, for example. There's lots of opportunities there where we as engineers can make a difference. So what's that going to look like? Well, for the Environment Agency, more and more CCTV cameras so we can manage the way we attend site and provide support services. We can do that more efficiently. We're looking at renewable energy. So you can see a floating solar array there. And we're looking at different fuels for our vehicles. And also, in terms of society, we're going to see a lot more woodland creation as we look to offset our carbon emissions and look at carbon sequestration, like creating new peat bogs. There's a floating community that you can see here that's in Amsterdam, which is fascinating. So there, in terms of increases in flooding, they're really not going to be impacted hugely. And sustainable transport is key to this as well. Integrated transport has to be something that has to be on the table and very much part of the work that we do. And COVID-19 offered a fantastic opportunity to increase walking and cycling in our cities. This slide, this describes the picture that we have at the Environment Agency, but the takeaway from this slide is that you don't have to have the whole picture right from the word go. It's okay to have an idea, to have an ambition or a vision, and then to work on that, and then gradually find the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle that help you identify the way that you can make a difference. And I think that's another talk altogether. I haven't got time to go through all of those things there, but yes, start with your vision and then work on pulling together the pieces of the puzzle that you need to be able to make the difference in your sphere, in your sector, in your industry. And of course, we all have this common framework now of the SDGs where we can hook our projects, our programs to these goals, and we can understand the contribution that we can make to the SDGs to make a difference in the world. So how can you get involved? There's quite a number of forums that have been set up now: the Institution of Civil Engineers, Infrastructure Projects Authority, the I3P, the Innovation Body, the Women's Engineering Society for Climate Emergency, the Institution of Asset Management Climate Change Group, there's the Green Construction Board, and there's this Net Zero Carbon Forum for Syria. So there's so much going on. This isn't the whole list. There's a lot more groups that are happening. So if you want to get involved, you can Google any of these or contact me at any time. I'll be really pleased to hear from you. So if you have any questions about any of that, I'd be really pleased to take those. Thank you very much for listening.